BC TV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening and welcome to Poets Pause. My name is Marilyn Klimcho. I'll be your host for this evening. I want to start the evening off by reminding everybody that Berks Bards has gone back to meeting in person. We're pre-taping this on a Friday, and so last night was our first Thursday in person in 2 years. And we were at the Goggle Works on the first floor in the cafe space. And it was really, really wonderful. So I invite everybody to come to the next one in May. That's at 6 o'clock on the first Thursday of every month. And bring your poetry and bring your friends' poetry. Yeah. Okay, yeah. My guest tonight likes this poem by Christina Rossetti. Who has seen the wind? Who has seen the wind? Neither I nor you. But when the leaves hang trembling, the wind is passing through. Who has seen the wind? Neither you nor I. But when the trees bow down their heads, the wind is passing by. That's a lovely poem. And I am going to describe my guest as a combination of Shel Silverstein, which if you remember reading poetry to your kids, that's the guy, Dr. Seuss. Also, you were reading books by him to your kids, and Mr. Rogers. And he's every one of those people, all wrapped into one. So, you know what? I forgot to ask you how you pronounce your last
name. Like a bowl of tea. Tietbohl, like a bowl of tea.
Dr. Tietbohl. Yeah. That was one thing I forgot to do. Dr. Tietbohl is a licensed psychologist, and he's been licensed since 1995. And listening to people's experience has been a key part of his work, and his talks directly and indirectly reflect therapeutic aspects. And he's had over 100 plus poetry performances for adults and children, many of which I participated in. He's been published in Hanukkah Lights, holiday poetry anthology, I would assume. In the I Can Read Harper Collins Publishing group. He's had poems in Spider Magazine, Ladybug Magazine. These are all ones aimed at children, I would assume. Where else? I'm losing my spot. Pen and Ink Newsletter. And he's also published The Monster Within, a rhyming and coloring books. Rhyming Coloring Books, and a poetry anthology, I Write Books and Other Tales. And the biggest book I think you're known for is called Sailing to Calencia. So, Dr. Phillip Tietbohl, welcome to Poets Pause.
Thank you, Marilyn. Thanks for having me.
I am so glad you came.
Me too.
Now, I understand that you have, and one of the reasons why I booked you for this month of April, is that you have an upcoming
workshop
with, hang on, let me check my notes.
Where did it go?
With the National
Association.
And I wrote that word so badly that I can't read it.
The National Association. I also do handwriting on the side, actually.
Do you? Yes. National Association of Poetry Therapy. Yeah. And essentially, I would assume that their focus of their program, which is later this month, is that going to be on Zoom?
It is. It's a conference they're putting on for membership, and you have to pay. But it's a 5-day conference from the 27th of April to May 1st. And I'm doing a workshop, Building Bridges, of Commonality. And I'm going to do some of the group poems with them on Zoom that I did with the kids that we've...
Oh my gosh. So basically what you and I did for quite a while was to go around to Berks County Libraries and kind of the pandemic kind of put a quash on that, but we would go to libraries and schedule occasions when we could work with small children and even teens.
Yeah, teens.
And we would end up doing a group poem.
Yeah.
I mean, you would read some of your stuff to begin and get everybody going. But yeah, I have watched you work and you are an amazing person, sir.
Well, it helps to have a cheering team, you know.
Yeah. But damn. Yeah. So why don't you share some of your work with us? Because I don't think the audience knows you.
Should I give a little background on how this all developed?
If you would like.
Briefly, so the group poem idea that she mentions, you know, is it developed about me just being a dad reading for my kids in their elementary schools. Mm-hmm. And I'd go in, I went into kindergarten, read poems. And what would happen is, you know, Jimmy would stand up and say, "I had cereal for breakfast." And then some other person would say, "My dog's name is Teddy." And I quickly realized the kids didn't just want to hear me. They wanted to tell their story.
Yes.
So I started pausing at the end of the of a stanza, and they would chime out the finish. And then I thought, what if they wrote the whole poem? So I would go up on the blackboard and write an idea, like ice cream or kindness or getting along or something. And they would generate ideas like we did in the libraries, you know. And then from their ideas, they would write a poem. And so I realized the poems tell their story. So this was the one from a group of three second grade classes, 90 kids chiming out lines. They wrote, "I'm a special animal." The theme was just animals. But they wrote it, "I'm a special animal. Animals are fuzzy, animals are fast. Kangaroo is quick, turtles always last. Gorillas like to climb, eagles rule the sky. Dogs are very friendly, but I'm a little shy."
That is, you know, that is fantastic. And it's a kind of a group think.
A group idea.
Without filters.
Exactly.
And I think that's why it works so well. Because those kids, you know, they're sitting around, their mommy's in the background,
People,
and they're happy, they're on the floor, they're sitting on a letter of the alphabet.
Yeah.
You know.
And they're contributing, they're sharing. I didn't write one word of those lines, you know, I just helped them edit it on the spot.
Right.
You know.
And the other thing I noticed from watching you work is that you read it with respect.
In other words,
someone who is consciously condescending would, you know, they wouldn't read it with respect. But because I hear you read it with respect, and your kids in the audience hear you read it with respect, they begin to know that they are writing poetry.
And they have value, and their voice matters.
Yes.
You know, when I do my poetry, I might go through 30 edits on a poem.
Right.
But when we do it with there, I try to use whatever word they use. Even the syllables, sometimes it won't quite have the perfect rhythm, but who cares? It's a moment in time that they wrote in rhyme. And I think that does convey respect, using their words.
Yeah, and it's just that, you know, poetry is a little bit of elevated language.
Right.
And that's what you're doing. You're letting them know that this is elevated, and they sense it. And I think that's fantastic.
And it's also, I've realized, poetry is the beat of mother's heart. You know, your first poem you heard was called "Your Mother's Heart." You know, love, dub, 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 dub. And then, you know, you're reading poetry to kids because the rhythm helps them learn.
Right.
And then sometimes they grow apart from it, but then they get it in songs.
Right.
And then they write their own, and then, you know, poetry connects us all.
Right.
One that I often read that you like and have said you liked is "What to Serve for Lunch."
That's the best one.
And I'll say, you know, the title is kind of a puzzler. You got to think about the title, "What to Serve for Lunch." And then I'll just go, "At breakfast this morning, Matthew caught us by surprise when he gobbled up his high chair right before our eyes. He started with the tray. He ate it hunk by hunk. Then he grabbed the backrest, which he swallowed in one chunk. He munched the legs in rungs as if some tasty treat. He licked his fingers clean, then he polished off the seat. Each bite, he seemed to savor. He seemed to like the flavors, and he seemed to like the crunch. Each bite he seemed to savor. Now what to serve for? And the kids chime out, lunch. But I've also done that at retirement communities, nursing
yes.
homes. You know, I did this
yes.
with kids. And then I was consulting to some therapy programs up in Schuylkill County. And I thought, well, maybe the kids in these programs could do it.
Right.
And, you know, they were a little skeptical, but they did a 40-minute program. One was called Self-Care and Safety. And they wrote, take care. Again, I didn't write a word. Food, pizza, tacos, be careful when you cook. Make sure you take a look, but don't eat the book. I have to walk the dog. Mom said, watch the road. Weather calls for fog and a big load of toads. So after I did this twice, they're like, we're going to do this more often. We did it the next summer. But it was for a group of kids that, you know, were in a therapy program. And then my mom went to Country Meadows and my dad, and I was thinking, well, maybe they would like this. So I approached someone there and gave them the flyer, and Kelly said, yeah, let's have you back. So we did about 20 and actually made a book, the Country Meadows Collection.
Very good.
You know, and do you want to hear one of them that I thought
sure,
was beautiful?
Sure, sure, sure.
So they wrote Our Heritage. The theme was I Wish. So I wrote I Wish, and then they generated ideas. The one lady said, he forces us to think, but they loved it. And they wrote Our Heritage. Love and kindness, peace of mind, brings happiness all the time. Memories of those who left us behind. Grandma and grandpa are one of a kind. We're thankful for those who made us who we are. We need to do our best because we are their shining star. And I didn't write a word.
Yeah, I know. I know. These group poems, like yeah. I said, they kind of
connect us. And they,
yeah, and they kind of blow me away because they are so good.
And people, I did one at the Goggle Works the other day for teens, and there was very few people. In fact, there were two.
Oh no!
And the one person said, well, this isn't going to work, and I don't see how this is going to work.
Yeah.
And, you know, they wrote a poem, and they made me contribute one line. I think I have it here. It was pretty cool. I wrote, How to Love My Life. So the theme was what matters to me.
Okay.
And they brainstormed, well, actually, I have it. They brainstormed all these ideas. Well, it was just like this one. They brainstormed the ideas. And they wrote, how can I love my life? How can I find respect? With all the stuff that matters, where will my life direct? With all my friends and family, pets and strangers too, all the people beside me, or the day becoming new. How to keep on helping? How to keep on moving? While keeping independence, continuously improving. I know it in my heart, how to do my part. Where I need to start is to share my art.
And there were only two kids.
Two people. They made me contribute one line.
I
think I contributed the healing one. Yes, I contributed how to keep on helping.
But
and then they went with it, how to keep on moving while keeping independence, continuously improving.
Yeah.
So I didn't write the lecture for them.
Yeah.
Sure.
And let me just share this with you. Hmm. It's. I've been doing poetry workshops for at Burke's Encore out in Douglasville.
Gotcha, yeah.
And it was my first time doing it, and I was very quickly learned that there are a lot of limits with an older group of people. A lot of them are, their hands are cramped. Mm. They can't hold a pencil or a crayon. Mm. You know, they feel
mobility
kind of...
Mobility sometimes,
They feel kind of like disenfranchised.
So
what I did is for November, last November, I did drawings of leaves, the shapes of leaves, and then I put simple sentences on it about the fall, with no attempt to make any kind of rhyme or anything.
Mm.
And I got the participants to color the leaves, cut them apart, and throw them in a pile in the center of the table, and then I asked them to play in the leaves.
Play in the leaves.
And they had to take...
Oh, I love that.
They had
play
to take
the leaves.
the material and then make a poem.
Oh, I love it. Then make a poem.
And some of them were just using it as inspiration, and they would write their own poem. And other people were just like, oh. And I had such participation. There were two people that I thought, you know, they don't get poetry. Right. They don't care. It's not going to be their thing. And they were enthusiastic when I finished. Wow. And I was just like, I've got to do this again.
Again, yeah. Yeah. They were active. They came alive. Yes. They reached in and they picked someone else's leaf maybe and it had an idea.
Yeah, whatever. Yeah.
I love that. Play in the leaves.
Okay. Yeah. Now, you write your own stuff.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Let's get to this book.
Oh, thank you.
Which is available on Amazon called Sailing to Calencia.
Yeah. And other poems of kindness, understanding, and love.
And let me just throw in that your work is available on poetrythatworks.com.
Yeah,
right?
I have a website and an Instagram and a Facebook and a Gmail, and it's all Poetry That Works.
Good.
so this book is an interesting collection. It's an island on the Calencian Sea where kindness is the answer, creating what might be. It's on the equator because everyone's treated equal in the island. So the first eight poems are about getting there and the journey there. And I'm going to read some of these Monday night with Dr. Joe Amprey for Diversity, The Wider Vision. So if you want to hear some from the Calencia first half, tune in then. I'm going to read a few from the second half, which is just a collection of poems, some of them written back when our kids were little, and you know, just the whole range. This one's called Wherever You Are. And it actually started because my brother Doug told me about his granddaughter Kaylee at the ocean saying to her mom, how old are the waves? So I wrote Played in the Leaves like you did, you said, because he told me that and I'm like, that's beautiful. So I wrote Wherever You Are. And it has a drawing that my daughter did of a fish. It's way to here. How old are the waves? How far is away? Where does wind go at the end of the day? How quick is my shadow? How big is the moon? How long is a visit? And when is it soon? How does sun heat us from high in the sky? If I'm light as a feather, then why can't I fly? Who made this seashell? Why needles, not leaves? What bounces a ball and what causes a sneeze? What's inside a puddle? What's under the sea? When you were at work, do you still think of me? How strong is a spider? How hard must I try? How fast is a blink in a blink of an eye? What bends a rainbow? Why does it glow? If I keep on growing, how tall will I grow? What makes an echo? What sparkles a star? Do I brighten your day wherever you are? So I wrote that as like a kid asking all the questions, you know.
And with a poet's ear, you hear something and you say, that's a poem.
Mm. You know, I guess when you said play in the leaves, that's going to be one. I was talking to a coach the other day and we came up, she said, if great had legs, Dina Breslin. And I'm like, oh my gosh. And I have a 2-page poem. If great had legs, where would it go? What would it do? What would it know?
Yeah,
so
wonderful.
I carry paper with me, and I tell people to carry two pens because one can go out of ink. Of course, that's a dinosaur. Now everyone has cell phones.
Oh, I don't care.
But there's something about writing with pen, you know, that brings it together.
Well, it focuses you. It focuses.
It's something about getting it out of your brain. So this one is relevant because of all the books we have here. It's called Books Take You There. Coral reef or county fair, books can take you anywhere. Atop a windmill making power inside the bud of a budding flower. To the stables, to the races, let the story take you places. To the future, to the past, books build friendships built to last. Books ignite, books can spark, books can weather storms in dark. Books enlighten, books inspire, and books survived a banned book fire. A page of words with a point and purpose can change the course of a school of porpoise. You don't need a fancy car to reach the inside of a star. All you need is a place to read. In time, you'll find a book-filled mind. I like that one, book-filled mind, but... Do we have time for more?
We do. They flashed up 10 minutes.
10 minutes. We got some time.
So we got some time.
Kindness tea. There's also the leaves, you know, is interesting. Kindness tea. You want to do that one, maybe?
Sure.
Okay. It's a cup of kindness tea. And, you know, maybe we all need this. I know I need reminders to drink it. A cup of kindness tea, some for you, some for me. A nourishing refreshment of what the world can be. The recipe, a starting point, can't dictate how you do it. Must go beyond instructions and add yourself into it. Take leaves of lettuce help you. The bark of you're okay. The roots of you are worth it. The seeds of a new way. Add sprinkle of acquaintance and extract the stranger fear. Add syrup of acceptance and toss in bowl of cheer. Pour through the ingredients, water boiling hot. Fold in twigs of tenderness and simmer in the pot. With splash of staying open, a bit of I need you. A hint of here is all we have, let flavors percolate through. Mix it all together with spoon of yes we can. Perhaps a pinch of we all count, a dash of understand. This tea is a concoction of what we say and do. A priceless gift, it gives a lift, a purposeful, practical brew. A cup of kindness tea, some for you, some for me. Please have an extra helping of cup of kindness tea.
Like I said.
You like it?
Yes. and like I said to the to the audience, I mean, Shel Silverstein's in there with that high chair thing. Mr. Rogers is there, you know, because you can deal with all levels of people. And Dr. Seuss is there because you're a little crazy.
Yes, very whimsy and silly and, you know, childlike. You know, that's something I learned.
Yes.
Childlike is terrific. And that keeps you alive till you're 100.
Yep.
You know.
And nobody can argue with
childlike
you.
Childlike is, they're curious, they're inquisitive. And I just realized this is a beautiful conversation. And that's what I do all day long. I have conversations with people. When we do a group poem, it's a conversation with the group.
Yeah.
And when you're out traveling, walking in Reading, you have conversations. It's the one thing about cell phones, sometimes they chop into conversations. And that's, I'm guilty of it too at times. But, you know, if you turn them off, then you're waiting in line. You might talk to the person next to you.
Yes.
They may say something, you write their idea, and it's a poem.
Yeah. So share some more, because we're down to 5 or 6 minutes, and I don't want to cut you off.
Well, your books, Go Tell the King is interesting. This one came because one morning in 2018 or 19, I looked out the window and just the leaves, one of them, this tree, was just dropping leaves, yellow ones. So it was cold, it was November. I went out and sat there and just watched, and it was just unbelievable. And so I wrote, the title's bizarre, Go Tell the King. The leaves are falling. Go tell the king. Let harpers harp and singers sing. In clusters and bunches, they're leaving the tree. Go tell the king so the king can see. Some pirouetting, some dropping straight down, some whirling and twirling their way to the ground. Some leap from the limb, full ready to go. They welcome the fall, the thrill of the show. Some are debating to stay with the tree, keep holding on, or let go and be free. Some flutter, then float as if caught in a trance, puffed by the wind on their one-way dance. Some could be featured in Broadway productions, their spinning gyrations, hypnotic inductions. Some deserve clapping and standing ovations, their on-point ballets deserve king adulations. Some pausing on branches they met on their way, reclining and resting, enjoying the play. Some waltz to a stop at the end of their drop. Some glide to the side for the last of their ride. Some rustle, some crinkle, some hardly a sound. A magical carpet now carpets the ground. The leaves are still falling, still leaves on the tree. Go tell the king so the king can see.
That is.
I don't know why the king came in there, but it was just, it seemed like something important that everyone should know.
Yeah.
Poems, they connect us, they're the beat of mother's heart. I think that's why every culture has different ones, you know. German, they have ein, zwei, Papagei, you know, in Spanish, un elefante se balanceaba sobre un tele de una araña. An elephant balances in the web of the spider. But they're all rhythmic, you know, it's songs, it's love, it's how we connect, I think.
And
poetry.
It's your special talent to do that. If you've got more, we probably have about 4 minutes left.
Interesting, you know. I could kick off a sailing to Galicia to get you started to the island, short ones.
Okay.
So this is called Sailing to Galicia, the inside cover, or the inside pages. The call. Belongings packed, boat prepared, sailing to Galicia. Glad the post was shared. The post. The island announcement straightforward and clear. We welcome all callers all through the year. The faster you get here, the lighter your craft, the less that you carry, the more you will laugh. Remember essentials, of those, leave half. You'll do better with less. It's Galician math. Bring books that you love. We share what we read. We cherish ideas. Each book plants a seed. Life will be simple, enchanted, some say. The island will teach if you're willing to play. Unknowns may puzzle, unknowns attract. We're sailing to Galicia. We won't be turning back.
So, would you do your, your workshop with the National Association of Poetry Therapy?
Yes.
Are you going to do a group poem with them?
Hopefully two of them. The theme is unity, hope, and transition.
Okay.
It's an hour and a half, so my thought is in the first hour, kind of do what we just did. Tell them about me reading poems for the kids and them chiming out. Share some of the group poems about ice cream. Then the therapy ones about getting along and kindness and love. And the ones from Country Meadows. And then for the next hour, do two, one on unity, and get them to brainstorm, you know, what brings us together? And then in my little room, I have a big whiteboard, write their ideas, and then edit two poems.
That sounds good. Now, I also noticed you've got some work from...
Well, a new one. I'm working on a second collection called A Twist of Hope, Rhymes of Healing, Caring, and Love. And this is a sample of the cover. It's not quite ready with the font, but it has it's going to have 110 poems of healing, caring. And the chapters are tied to problems, but they're all written positively, like hope and growing, creating and thriving. The last chapter is circling and cycling, you know. So I thought I could read this short one called You'll Always Be. It's in the parenting section. So I wrote this thinking of kids. You'll always be. Mountains may crumble, fish leave the sea, you'll always be what matters to me. Craters discovered, covered by trees, you'll always be what matters to me. Planets detected, a new galaxy, you'll always be what matters to me. Coyotes run free, crypt mystery, doctors decree, and dictators flee. Time off to travel, places to see, but you'll always be what matters to me.
And on that crest of that wave, we've got about probably 45 seconds left or so. So let me remind my audience that First Thursday is on the first Thursday of every month, and Burke's Bards is meeting at 6 p.m. In the Goggle Works in the cafe space. And bring your work, because generally speaking, there's always going to be an open mic. My guest has been...
That's where you first met me, was I read What to Serve for Lunch, and after I did, you're like, we got to do something.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Yeah, we saw your work, and Angie Chappelle Mims and
right.
I both went like, you're our guy. We had this wonderful little gap we had to fill with
young
making the libraries.
Yes.
Yes, because they needed programming in the libraries for young kids. And
we've done a lot. Fleetwood, Sinking Spring, Schuylkill. We did a whole bunch of them.
Yeah.
And we did a few online.
Yeah. Well, anyway, so I guess this is the end of the program.
Thank you so much, Marilyn, for having me and letting me perform a little. And I just appreciate your love and support.
All right. Well, thank you so much. And I'll see you next time.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.